his capabilities. When we compare the cost and performance of today's computer, computer technology has made incredible progress in the past 60 years, which any other technology or industry has not made. A computer which was costing 1 million rupees in 1985 is now available for about 25,000 rupees only, with more performance, much more memory and much more storage. How this improvement in performance have come through the various years? Let us have a look into that. Initially, it was only the technology and the initial architecture with which the progress was made. And there was a steady progress of 25% growth every year. Then technology played a major role. And from late 1970s onwards, because of microprocessor technology and integrated circuit technology, this 25% growth has increased to 35% performance every year. Then came a greater role for architectural improvements, both in software and in hardware, which from 1980 onwards, moving away from the assembly language, introduction of standard operating systems, RISC processor and ILP, has been ruling the industry for 16 years. Every year we had about 52% growth. And this growth of 52% has dipped a little. From 2002 onwards, the performance dipped means not below. The growth has dipped and the progress was 20% per year. Then again, from 2005 onwards, multiprocessor architecture and multi-core architecture, thread level parallel processing, data level parallel processing, graphic processing, all these things are taking over and it sustains the growth further. What do we mean by changes in technology? We had originally valves, which changed into transistors and integrated circuits and very large scale integrated circuits. Then there was an improvement in clock speed, which was originally in terms of a few kilocycles. Now it has come into gigahertz. And multiprocessor and multi-core architectures have been introduced. In a small chip, you will have many more processors and many more cores. And the core memory originally has been replaced by DRAM technology chips. And the wired communication has been changed to wireless communication. And the original CRO screens have been made to touch screens now. Architectural changes, if we look into, there is a larger use and a large number of registers. And we use now high-level language as a system software. And operating system has been introduced. Microprogram control has been introduced. Multiprogramming, multitasking has been introduced. Increased use of firmware and embedded systems have been brought in. Pipelining, instruction level parallel processing, DLP, TLP, graphic processing, all these things have taken place. And these are all the architectural changes we talk about. As I said earlier, the growth pattern is like this curve. Initially, there was about 25% growth. Then it increased to 52%. Then it was rolling over a longer period. Then around 2002, there was a slight dip. And then further, because of multi-core use of the DRAM technology, that is the memory, it is not that good when compared to the processor, and it is coming, I mean, it is not able to cope up with that. There is a large gap, but somehow the architecture is going to play a major role in bridging the gap by the kinds of introducing pipeline processing, out of order execution, and thread level parallel processing. All these things are going to bridge the gap. Thereby, the system has a better performance. Growth has taken in two ways. More complex components, as defined by Moore's law, it doubled in 18 months, every 18 months. And also, each component has become more complex and more number of components. And the technology has brought in size reduction in all these components, and that is why now you see all your mobile systems or pocket, personal device, mobile devices are very small, but still it has much more capabilities when compared to any other system. Let us try to see all these things, and all these things have happened because of technological development and architectural changes, that is why I said earlier. And as a computer science engineer or an IT professional, one should know what are technological changes and architectural changes that have brought in this much of performance. And the technological changes we have seen, architectural changes also we have seen. We'll go a little bit detail into that. Let us now see what is meant by a computer architecture. As a definition, we can define that as structure and behavior of a computer system as visualized by a programmer working at assembly level or machine language level. By which we mean, it's a conceptual model of a computer at a particular level of abstraction, having that view Eminence is the criterion and caste is not a criterion. That is how the computers are designed for those machines which are put into satellites and things like that. Otherwise, the size is not a criterion, power is not a criterion, then you can have large systems that would be occupying your desktop or you can any way you place it. One should remember that there are different systems for different functional requirement, I said even earlier, and for that you have to design for the best performance. A lorry or a truck or a bus, car or even a race car do the same function of transporting, but what is the difference? Is it a weight that is to be taken care of, or the number of persons to be transported, or is it the comfort or the speed that is important? Based on that only a vehicle is designed. In a similar way, a computer has to be designed based on the functional requirements. And I said earlier, this task would include instruction set design, functional organization, logical design, implementation, and the implementation would include IC design, packaging, power and cooling. So a computer architect would require the knowledge, a wide knowledge in the ranges of technologies, compilers, OS, logic design and packaging. So even as a user of a system, one should know what his system should be capable of doing. You should know what your system can do and what functionalities it can perform for you. You must know. And the type of system is purely based on the functional requirements. Selection of a system based on the requirement and performance has to be done. So as an engineer, as a user, you should know how to select a system, for what purpose and how much performance you want. When it is a new computer system, you will really look into the essential functional requirements, components, constraints, all those things, and once you specify all these things, then only you will be in a position to decide what you are going to get or what you want to have. As I said earlier, the computers can be classified into different categories, again depending on the functional requirements. It could be personal mobile devices, or it could be desktop computing systems, or it could be large servers. Even in servers, you will have different kinds of servers, and you also have embedded computers, which would mean your processor is going to be very small, less time consuming, like that. Here it says, as such embedded systems, performance on real-time execution is important. It will have minimum memory and it should consume minimized power. Servers can be large, it should have dependability, scalability and efficient throughput. Number of transactions per minute is a criteria. Like that, every system has its own criteria, its own function, have seen what are all the components of computer architecture, both in terms of technology as well as in other computer architecture components in software. We have also seen what would